What's up, church family? My name is Josh, and today is Sunday, September 6th. Welcome to First Baptist Hendersonville Online. Thank you so much for joining us online for worship this morning. Our church is about connecting every generation to God, others, and service. So whether you're watching on Facebook or on the new online campus, would you go ahead and just leave a comment and let us know where you're watching from today? We want to make sure you're connecting with others online. So in the Facebook comments and the chat room on the online campus, just let us know where you're watching from this morning. Pastor Bruce is continuing his series today through the book of Hebrews, and he'll be talking about Jesus as our high priest. So at this time, go ahead and grab your Bible, maybe a cup of coffee, turn up the volume for music and worship. Welcome to First Baptist Hendersonville Online.
On earth. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. That's a couple of Red Bull songs right there. If that doesn't get you going, you're dead. I'm telling you, there's no hope for you this morning. Jesus saves. You know, this past summer, because of the virus, our student ministries and our children's ministries weren't able to do all that we had hoped. But they're doing some things now. And in the fall, we had a retreat the last couple of days for our preteens at our church farm. Had about 100 fourth and fifth graders out there. And on Friday night, five of those preteens understood what it meant for Jesus to become their Savior. Jesus saves. You know, virus is not going to hold down the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Church is moving forward, and we're seeing some incredible things take place as people are coming to faith in Jesus Christ. I believe our best days are yet in front of us as we look forward to what God is going to do. I want to say a word of welcome to those of you that are guests. We're so happy you're here today. We want you just to feel a part of the church family this morning. But we'd love to know about you being here today. There's a little white card in the pew rack in front of you. If you wouldn't mind filling that out sometime during the service. At the end of the service, Pastor Chester and I are going to be out at the Welcome Center. If you wouldn't mind just bring that card out to us out in the Welcome Center, we'd love to meet you. We have a gift for you, but just more than anything else, let you know how special you are and how happy we are that you're here today. Let's bow together in prayer time, and then Greg's going to come back and continue to lead us in our musical worship. Our Father, this morning, most of us in this room understand that song that Jesus saves, because we can go back and we can see a time when we knew we were without Christ and we were dead in our trespasses and sins, but Jesus glorious saved us. I pray if there's one person in this room today that does not know Jesus Christ, that before they walk off this campus, they will know that they know that Jesus is their Lord and their Savior. Father, we pray that you will anoint our pastor this morning with your Holy Spirit. We pray that you will give him the words that you have spoken to him this week. And those words will be exactly what we need. Lord, today, prepare our hearts to hear. Prepare our minds to receive. Lord, if we have unconfessed sin, reveal it so we can confess it and stand clean before you this morning. Lord, may our hearts, our minds be open to what you have for us as we worship you through Jesus Christ. Amen.
I lift my hands. sees my brokenness and carries me when I am frail and weak. Jesus, it is you. Oh, who tells the storm to rest when I am overwhelmed and cannot speak? Jesus, it is you. Oh, who wears my guilt on his shoulders?
Here and me. Aren't you God we serve, a faithful God? Let's stand together. My favorite hymn. I love it because he's been so faithful to me. Sing it with me.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou takest not thy compassion in thee, as thou hast read thy forever.
You may be seated. Today we sing because of his powerful, transforming love. Every breath we breathe, every heartache we endure, every loss we sustain, every victory we win, it's all been made worthy and given purpose somehow. He refuses to let any of it go to waste, and he takes back from the enemy what was stolen and turns it into something meaningful, valuable, and beautiful. All we are, all that happens to us, is wonderfully, tenderly, faithfully redeemed.
Lost in the long ways could I go, but to the one who was waiting for me. Though I fell at his feet, he brought me to his side and embraced away my pain and misery. Only his love could show and only his blood.
thank the Lord we are redeemed. That was Angela De Freitas. She and her husband Marcelo are some of our newest American citizens. They're from Brazil and recently became Americans. We're glad to have them in our church. Well, several weeks ago, I mentioned in a sermon, I used as an illustration, a little book of Bible promises. You may remember that. And I got tired of having to send people a link where they could get some of those. I must have been asked, I don't know how many times, but a lot of times. So Bruce ordered all that the supplier had. He got them all. So we sold out of them in the first service this morning. So you can't get any of them because they're gone. But we're going to get some more. As soon as we can, we'll get some more. And they really didn't have that many. But what they did have, I think 50 or so that they did have, and those disappeared after the first service this morning. So we'll let you know when we get some more of those in. I say that because if you see somebody with one and you ask them where they got it, then you're going to come looking for it, and we don't have any more. So we'll get some more, and I'll tell you when we get them. Well, today we're going to take a journey through several passages. And I'm going to tell you up front, this is an easy part of Hebrews to get lost in and to finish it and kind of scratch your head and say, wait a minute, what? So I want to show you several things this morning, and we're going to meander a little bit. You know, there are two ways to take a trip to go somewhere, and I like both of these ways. One, you can just have a destination and you go there and take your trip. Now, getting there is a pain. Getting there is not part of the trip. You have to pay the price to get there. It may be on an airplane or a car, whatever it is, but that's just an evil you have to go through. And when you finally get there, then you flip the switch and you're on vacation and it starts, right? You can relax. But sometimes getting there is the destination. Now, Joy and I took a trip like that this summer. You may hate a trip like this. Occasionally, we enjoy doing this. We just kind of meandered. We went up to the Ark up in northern Kentucky, saw the replica of Noah's Ark. We went up through the cornfields of Ohio and up into Michigan. And we really didn't have an itinerary or an agenda. We were just kind of wandering. We were just going where the road led. And if we saw something that was interesting, we stopped. And just from kind of place to place. And it's just two different ways to do something. Well, sometimes in the Bible, particularly in the book of Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews just makes a beeline to the destination. He just gets right to the point, and he makes his point, and he puts an exclamation point at the end of it. But sometimes he meanders, and he goes through other places to make his point. Now, we're in a meandering passage today. We're going to read in Hebrews chapter 7, but before we get to that, we really need to read a couple of other passages. So here's what I want you to do today. Turn to Hebrews 7, and at the beginning of that chapter, or in the margin somewhere in that chapter, write down these two references. Because to really understand Hebrews chapter 7, you've got to understand these other two passages that go along with it. So write down somewhere there at the beginning of chapter 7, write down Genesis 14, verse 17, and a few verses that follow. Genesis 14, 17, and write down Psalm 110, chapter 110, verse 4. Now, those two Old Testament passages and what the writer of Hebrews says are the only things that we know about this man named Melchizedek. So let's go read those two Old Testament passages first before we read the Hebrews passage. So let's go to Genesis chapter 14. Now, again, I'm just trying to help you connect the dots here. So sometime if you're reading in Genesis 14, you need to be reminded that Hebrews 7 connects to this. So out beside Genesis 14, 17, write Hebrews 7. And it might be a good idea to write Psalm 110, verse 4. And now you've got those dots connected, and you see that those scripture passages all go together. Now let me give you background to what's going on in Genesis 14. A coalition of kings that the Bible just describes in the east, city-state kings, have come together to fight a war against Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, we're going to learn a lot about Sodom and Gomorrah later, right? But at this point, we don't know too much about Sodom and Gomorrah, but these kings are coming against Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, this is the first recorded war in the Bible, the first one that's mentioned. And they make up a coalition, and they come against Sodom and Gomorrah, and they defeat Sodom and Gomorrah, and they take the plunder, they take all the stuff that they want, and they take people as captives. They make them their slaves. And they leave Sodom and Gomorrah, not only with all of the possessions, but with all of the people. Now, when Abraham, who, by the way, as we read this, you'll see his name is still Abram. It has not yet been changed to Abraham, but that's who we're talking about. When Abraham got word of what had happened, he learned that a man named Lot had been taken captive along with all of these other people. Now, Lot was his nephew. And when he heard that nephew Lot had been taken captive, he decided he was going to do something about this. So the passage right before this says that Abraham got together 318 of his warriors from his own household. Now let that sink in. 318 warriors from his own household. You assume that they're all married and probably had a child or more. He had a pretty big household. He got 318 of his own warriors, and he went after those kings who had defeated Sodom and Gomorrah. He caught up to them and defeated them, and not only brought back all of the people that had been taken captive, but also he brought back all of the plunder, all of the possessions that they had taken with them. Now that's the background of what's happening and what we're about to read, okay? So you're caught up. Let's read beginning in verse 17. After Abraham, returned from defeating Chedorlaomer and the kings who were with him, the kings of Sodom went out to meet him in the valley of Sheva. That is the king's valley. Then Melchizedek. Now that's the first time his name has ever been mentioned. Then Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was a priest to God Most High. Now let me point out several things right there. You might want to circle the word king, and you might want to circle the word priest. Because those two things are going to become very important when we read Hebrews chapter 7 in this comparison between Melchizedek and Jesus. Now, most people in the Old Testament would have been a king or a priest, but not both. But this man was a king and a priest. It is a picture of Jesus who was going to come, who would be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and who would be our high priest. I want you to notice something else in that sentence, though. Did you notice that he brought bread and wine? Now, you can read through that so quickly, it just goes over your head. You don't think anything about it. But what is the symbol that we use, and we've used now for 2,000 years, what is the symbol that we use that Jesus gave us when we gather together and we remember the sacrifice that Jesus made on behalf of us to pay the price for our sin, when we remember his death and burial and resurrection, what are those symbols that we use? It is that bread and wine. It is significant that the writer of the book of Genesis used something that a long time later is going to be connected with Jesus himself. As the Holy Spirit inspired this, it is amazing how he tied all of this together. He was a priest to God Most High. Now, he uses that term, God Most High, three times. That's the first time that phrase has ever been used about God. God Most High. Look at verse 19. He blessed him. Now, who is he that's doing the blessing? He blessed him. Who blessed and who got blessed? He is Melchizedek. Melchizedek blessed Abraham. Now, keep in mind that the person who blesses someone else, the blessing is always from the superior to the inferior. Now, occasionally you'll hear somebody say, you know, if somebody gives a beggar a handout, the person will say, bless you, bless you, bless you. Well, they're just saying thank you. They're saying thank you. A person who actually blesses someone else, the blessing always goes from the superior to the inferior. So it's Melchizedek who's blessing Abraham. Abraham is blessed by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. I give praise to God Most High who handed over your enemies to you, and Abram gave him a tenth of everything. Now, you know that tenth represents a tithe, but this is before the tithe had ever come into existence. This is before anything about priests and tithes and all of that. And here you've got a picture of Abraham giving a tithe to Melchizedek. All right, let's read the passage in Psalms. Psalm 110, and again, out beside it, you might just want to jot down Genesis 14:17 and jot down Hebrews chapter 7. And now you've got all the dots connected. You've got lines going in every direction to show you every passage in the Bible that talks about Melchizedek. Now, Psalm 110 is a messianic prophecy. Everything in the 110th chapter is looking forward, telling us about the Messiah that is going to come. You'll notice in verse 1 it says, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." Who is that? That's Jesus. "The Lord will extend your mighty scepter from Zion, rule over surrounding enemies." That's Jesus. Look in verse 4. "The Lord has sworn an oath and will not take it back. Forever you are a priest like Melchizedek." Who is the you? It is the Lord Jesus. Now that's the background to what we're about to study. So now let's go to Hebrews. Let me tell you before I read this, the exposition of this passage, it turned on some lights, it rang some bells for these Hebrew believers because they had lived in this system. You and I have not lived in this system. We've studied about priests, we've studied about the law, we've studied about animal sacrifices, we've studied about temple worship, we've read about all of that, but we haven't lived in those things, and we're not really going to identify with this like the Hebrew believers did. He's writing this to Hebrews to remind them that Jesus is better and why they follow Jesus to start with. So I'm going to read the passage. When I finish reading it, you're going to scratch your head a little bit and say what? And I'm going to try to simplify and show you three things that this passage says. So let's read it first. That's always the place to start. Let's really begin in verse 20 of chapter 6. Jesus has entered there on our behalf as a forerunner. Remember last week we talked about that anchor that goes before. He's gone into heaven before us because he has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. "For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham and blessed him as he returned from defeating the kings, and Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, his name means king of righteousness, then also king of Salem, meaning king of peace. Without father, mother, or genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor ending of life, but resembling the Son of God, remains a priest forever. Now consider how great this man was. Even Abraham the patriarch gave a tenth of the plunder to him. The sons of Levi, who received the priestly office, have a command according to the law to collect a tenth from the people, that is, from their brothers, though they have also descended from Abraham. But one without this lineage collected tenths from Abraham and blessed the one who has the promises. Without a doubt, the inferior is blessed by the superior. In one case, men who will die receive tenths, but in the other case, Scripture testifies that he lives. And in a sense, Levi himself, who receives tenths, has paid tenths through Abraham, and he was still within his ancestor when Melchizedek met him. If then perfection came through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there for another priest to appear, said to be in the order of Melchizedek and not in the order of Aaron? For when there is a change of the priesthood, there must be a change of the law as well. For the one who these things are spoken about belonged to a different tribe. No one from it has ever served at the altar. Now it is evident that our Lord came from Judah, and Moses said nothing about that tribe concerning priests. And this becomes clearer if another priest like Melchizedek appears, who did not become a priest based on a legal command concerning physical descent, but based on the power of an indestructible life. For it has been testified, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. You got it? Now, we have a hard time grasping this, because even though we know about the law and priest and sacrifices and temple worship, we know about those things, but we haven't lived in those things. We haven't experienced them. When this was spoken to these Hebrew Christians, a light went off. They started connecting things, and they understood things that you and I don't fully grasp. So let me point out three things. Let me just simplify this. This is kind of the what is that book? If you're wanting to know how to do something, and it's a book for, it's a bad word to use, but a book for dummies, you know. I'm not saying that about you. I'm just saying, let me simplify this as best we can. Let me show you three things that this passage is talking about. Look at the first three verses. And what he's telling us there is basically a comparison between Melchizedek and Jesus. And this is the comparison. Melchizedek was a priest. Jesus is our high priest. Melchizedek was a king. Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And by the way, he was a king of Salem. And the word Salem, he said that in Hebrews. The word Salem means peace. Isn't it interesting that he was the king of peace and Jesus is the prince of peace? You see that comparison there? He's saying to them, just like Melchizedek came along and no one like Melchizedek had ever lived, now Jesus came along and no one like Jesus had ever lived, and that's why you follow Jesus to start with. Well, what was all of that stuff in verse 3 there about no father, no mother, he just kind of appeared and no ending? What's all that about? Is the Bible telling us that like Elijah and Enoch that Melchizedek never died? No, that's not it at all. Remember, the book of Genesis is a book of genealogy. It's a book of begats. So-and-so begat so-and-so, who begat so-and-so, who begat so-and-so. It gives us a genealogy about everybody that comes along. But when Melchizedek came along, there was nothing about that. There's no word about his parents. There's no word about his hometown. There's no word about how long he lived. All of the normal things that Genesis tells us about, it doesn't tell us anything about Melchizedek. He was just there, and then he's never mentioned again. That's a picture of Jesus who has always been. I had a child ask me this week. I don't know why he was thinking about Christmas already, but he said, when Christmas rolls around this year, how old will Jesus have been? And my answer to him was, Jesus is eternal. Jesus has always been. But if you're asking how long has it been since Jesus appeared on earth, since Jesus was born on earth, I can give you a number for that. But Jesus has always been. He's eternal. The book of Colossians chapter 1 says that all things were created by him and for him, and through him all things were made that were made. He has always been. That's that picture. He's just comparing Melchizedek in their mind. He's helping them see that Jesus is unlike any other. Now the second thing that he does starts in verse 4. And it goes down to verse 10. And he's telling them that Jesus is superior to Abraham. Now remember, these are Jewish people. So when you're talking about Abraham, you're talking about the big kahuna. I mean, you're at the top of the heap here. He's the guy. I mean, it was Abraham to whom the promises were given. It was Abraham who was the father of the Hebrew nation. Abraham was everything to these people. And what he's doing in those verses from 4 to 10 is showing them that Melchizedek was greater than Moses. Well, how do you figure that? Well, because he blessed Moses. And he points out that the one who gives the blessing is always superior to the one who receives the blessing. The inferior doesn't bless the superior blesses the inferior. And Abraham paid him a tenth, a tithe. This is before tithes were in existence. That had not been taught yet. And yet instinctively, Abraham knew that he was to give Melchizedek something. He was showing that Melchizedek was greater than Abraham. And now he's making a case for Christ. Have you ever read that book, A Case for Christ? That's a great book. You ought to read it. He's making a case for Christ. He's reminding them that Jesus is better than anything they've ever known. Now, you and I have a hard time grasping all of this, but it was ringing a bell with these Jewish believers. Now, the third thing that he does starts there in verse 11 and goes down to verse 17. And basically, he's saying there, if I could just paraphrase that, he's saying that perfection only came through Jesus Christ. He starts it there in verse 11 by saying, if perfection could be found in the priests, in the law, then would we have needed any other type of priest? Would we have needed anything else if perfection could have been found in the law? Now, the obvious answer to that is yes. If, in fact, perfection could have been found that way, that would have been all we needed. But no, perfection could not be found that way. And so something better came along. Now, what is the something better that came along that's better than the law? It's grace. He talks about that toward the end of the passage that we just read. It's grace. Never forget that we're saved by God's grace. We're not saved because we keep the law. We keep the law because we've been saved. We're saved by grace. People sometimes wonder, how were people in the Old Testament saved? And some people think that folks in the Old Testament were saved by keeping the law. In the New Testament, we're saved by grace. Look, people have always been saved the same way. It was counted unto Abraham as righteous because he was a man of faith. He believed God, and it was counted unto him as righteous. We're not saved because we do the right things. We do the right things because we've been saved. So he talks about perfection and how perfection only comes through Jesus Christ. Now, if I were about to wrap this sermon up, and I'm not, but if I were about to wrap this sermon up, you would leave here saying, okay, I got some information. I don't fully understand it. I still got a couple of questions floating around in my mind, but I know a little bit more about Melchizedek than I did. I at least know the three places that you find out about Melchizedek. If all you left with was that, you would just have a little bit more biblical information. But as you know, I often come to a sermon point like this, and I say, so what is the so what of this passage? And that's Bible knowledge. That's Bible information. So what? How is that supposed to affect the way I live? How is that supposed to impact my life in the year 2020 and beyond? What does this have to do with the way I'm supposed to live my life? Okay, preacher, you gave us some information. So what? Well, here's the so what. There are two things that I want you to leave here today with the so what. Number one, never forget that he is our priest. He is our priest. You know, the word priest in Latin is the word pontifex. If you have a Catholic friend, that word pontifex, priest, comes out of it. It means bridge maker, bridge builder. And many people believe that it's their priest that is their bridge to God. Their priest gives them access to God. Look, with no offense to anyone else, we have a priest and his name is Jesus. And he has given us access to the creator of the universe. He is the one that allows us into the presence of God. You know, when you go back into the Old Testament, there was a limit to every person except one. About even to that one, there was a limit about how far a person could go in their closeness to God. Gentiles could only go so far on the Temple Mount area. There was a sign there. Imagine this. There was a sign that said, any Gentile that goes beyond this sign will be put to death. Can you imagine going to church and there's a sign that says that a certain person, if you cross this line, you would be killed for going past that? That's as close as they could get to God. There was another place that women had to stop. It was as far as you could go. It was the court of the women. You could go to that point, but then you couldn't go any further. That was as close to God as you could get. Then there was the court of the Jews, the men. They could go a little bit closer to God, but there was a stopping place for them too. They could not get any closer to God than that. And then the priest. They could go a little further, but even the priest had a stopping point. They had a limit. And only the high priest. Only one man, only one day a year could he go behind the curtain and into what they believed was the presence of God. When Jesus died on the cross, he tore that curtain in two and he gave us access to the Father. And it doesn't matter if you're red, yellow, black, and white. It doesn't matter if you are Jew or Gentile. It doesn't matter if you are male or female, because there is no Jew, Gentile, male, or female in Christ Jesus. He has given us access to God the Father. He is our high priest, and we can go into the presence of the one who created heaven and earth. You know, there's some important people in this world. VIPs, and you and I'll never be around them. Few of you may, but most of us will never be around those people. We won't have a meal with them. We won't ever be on a first name basis. We may see them on television. We may be somewhere and see them in person, but they won't know who we are, and to be honest, they don't care who we are. We'll never share a relationship with that person. But through Jesus Christ, listen to me, we have a relationship with the creator of the universe. God, who created everything out of nothing, knows your name. And he cares about you. And he has given you access
not into the Holy of Holies, but into the throne room of heaven through his Son, who is our high priest. Never forget, he is our priest. But number two, never forget, he's our king. Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You know, when you come into the presence of an authority, if you were in the military, you know that when you had a superior officer and they told you to do something, you didn't say, "Why do you want me to do that?" You didn't say, "I don't feel like doing that." You didn't say, "I don't know if that's a good idea." When a superior officer gave you an order, you did what they said to do. Jesus is our King. And what that means is we don't question what he says to do. We don't argue with what he says to do. We take his word as truth and we obey him because Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now I want you to see something before we go. I worked this week several days on memorizing something I heard in a sermon years ago by a man named S.M. Lockridge. S.M. was born in 1913. He died in the year 2000. I heard him preach several times. I would go across the country to hear S.M. Lockridge or E.V. Hill preach, two of the greatest preachers of my lifetime. S.M., his initials S.M., when I tell you what his mama named him, you'll know why they always called him S.M. His name was Shadrach Meshach Lockridge. If you were named Shadrach Meshach, you'd go by S.M. too, wouldn't you? S.M. Lockridge pastored a church in San Diego, California for almost all of his ministry. Great, great black preacher. I heard him preach this sermon. The sermon lasted about an hour. I heard him preach this sermon, and I wanted to take part of what he said at the end and use it in this sermon today. And the more I worked on it, the more I thought, why would I try to do this when I can just let you listen to S.M. say it himself? Now, nobody can say it like S.M. Lockridge said it. The sermon lasted an hour. I've pulled about 3 minutes. Aren't you glad I did? But I want you to listen to what S.M. Lockridge said about Jesus is our King. Watch this.
The Bible says he's a King of the Jews. He's a King of Israel. He's a King of righteousness. He's a King of the ages. He's a King of heaven. He's a King of glory. He's a King of kings. And he is the Lord of lords. Now that's my King. Do you know him? No means of measure can define his limitless love. Well, he's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. And he's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's God's Son. He's a sinner's Savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. Well, he's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. Do you know him? He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captives. He defends the thief. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. Do you know him? My King is a key of knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. He's a gateway of glory. Do you know him? His life is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. Well, I wish I could describe him to you, but he's indescribable. He's indescribable. Yeah. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. You can't get him out of your mouth. You can't get him off of your hand. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, Pharisees couldn't stand it, but they found out they couldn't stop it. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. That's my King. Yeah! He always has been, and he always will be. I'm talking about he had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. You can't even beat him, and he's not going to resign. That's my King.
Now, the so what of this message today is you leave here with those two thoughts sounding in your heart. He is our priest, and he is our King, and we will serve no other. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you that you're the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and you're the Prince of Peace. And I pray, Lord, that we would leave here committed, that Jesus is our King. We don't question, we don't have to understand. He is the King, and we will obey him and follow him. And I pray, Lord, that we will live as committed, devoted followers of the one who will live forever. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, we'd like to have an opportunity to talk to you today about your journey with Christ. If there's something going on inside of you, you need to talk with someone. Bruce and I are going to be out at the Welcome Center when we leave here. We'd love to talk with you. Just come by and tell us you want to talk, and we'll find a place. If you're a guest today and you filled out one of these guest cards, if you'll come by the Welcome Center and hand this to me, I'll exchange this for a gift. I've got a gift I'd love to give you. You'll enjoy it, and it'll give me a chance to meet you. So if you're a guest today, stop by out there on your way out. If you're at home and the Lord's spoken to you today and you want to talk with someone, if you just text to the number 99000, 99000, text the word START, one of our pastors will get in touch with you today, and we'll engage in a conversation with you about how Jesus can be your King as well. Thank you for being here, Greg. Let's sing before we... Oh, you look dapper today.
Thank you. Let's stand and sing before we go, and I hope you'll take these words with you. Aren't you glad you're redeemed? Amen. Let me try that one more time. I'm not sure you really know. Aren't you glad you're redeemed? Amen.
Yes.
There we go. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. His child and forever I am. Have a great week. See you next time.
Thank you so much for joining us online for worship this morning. Just like Pastor Bruce said, if you text the word START to 99000, one of our pastors will contact you and they can help you start a relationship with Jesus. Or maybe you have questions about baptism, or you just need somebody to pray with you. Or maybe you need help becoming a member at this church or a local church in your area. Just text the word START to 99000 and one of our pastors will contact you and help you take those next steps. We hope to see you live online this Wednesday night for Pastor's Bible Study, next Sunday morning live online for worship, or any day of the week at the online campus for replays of our worship services and online Bible studies. We'll see you soon.